When I approached our head of finance and told him that for this series of training videos on LED strip lighting, I'd need to buy an electric Aston Martin on the company ticket, he said to me, "How did you get this address? This is my bedroom and it's the middle of the night. Get out." This didn't answer my question, so after the tribunal hearing, we compromised and I got my electric Aston Martin. So why do I need it? Well, to help explain LED strip and one of the major things that can go wrong with it, I shrunk my car down to 1/32 the size and installed it on this Scalextric track. If you're watching this video on any of our social media accounts, click the link in the description to view it as part of our free training package to help you with your CPD, and you'll receive a certificate. If you're already watching it as part of that training package, we'll crack on. You see, LED strip is a bit like a Scalextric track. The track works by having these two rails connected to a DC supply in this case, then the car picks up the supply across these two brushes underneath and connects a motor inside here across the positive and negative, and the car goes. I've laid this one out in a straightish line rather than the traditional loop to help explain a point. You see, I've connected the power supply to this end of the track, and if I place my electric Aston Martin here at the power connection, it takes off nicely. However, what you'll notice is that as the vehicle gets towards the end of the track, it starts to slow down and lose power. The reason that the car is losing power at the end of the circuit is volt drop. As the car gets further and further away from the power source, the voltage gets steadily lower and lower, and that means that the car loses some power and can't move as quickly. LED strip is a lot like that Scalextric track. This one has two rails because it's a fixed colour strip. One of these rails is the positive and the other the negative, and individual groups of LEDs connecting groups from one side to the other along the length. So at the start of the circuit, close to the power supply, the voltage is nice and high. But as the circuit gets longer and longer, the voltage across the individual LEDs gets lower and lower. This can lead to noticeable dimming on very long runs. This effect is more pronounced with LED strip than with slot car races because the load on a slot car track is pretty much always at just one position that changes along the circuit, whereas the LED strip has the loads evenly spaced all the way along it. This makes the volt drop progressively higher along its length. This is why whenever you start looking at LED strip, you'll find that it has a maximum length that can be connected off a single power supply. For example, this Vegas strip from ROBUS has a maximum length of 10 meters for the white version and 5 meters for the RGB version. There is a slightly different version of this strip called the Vegas Ultra, which can be used for when you need long runs that can be up to 30 meters long. How does it do it? Well, to find out and to prove the importance of staying under these maximum lengths as well as the impact volt drop can have on LED strip, I sent some off to our independent testing facility in Skipton, North Yorkshire. Laid out on the bench here are two different types of strip. They both run on 24 volts. One of them is the Vegas Cob from ROBUS. For more information on Cob strip, see a previous video in this series. And the other is the Vegas Ultra. This particular variant of Cob strip has a maximum length of 10 meters, although a length of 5 meters is more common. Rather than connecting up long lengths of strip and measuring volt drop versus light output, we've hooked our strips up to a DC power supply where we can control the voltage to mimic the volt drop. So using this excellent light meter and MI3155 MFT from Mitrell, and this slightly less excellent homemade integrating sphere, we're going to measure the light output from the two strips as the simulated volt drop increases. Taking the Cob strip first, we start off at the full 24 volts that it requires, and you can see that the light output from the small section of strip covered by the integrating sphere is hovering around the 1870 lux mark. Now let's simulate taking that strip beyond the maximum recommended length and drop the voltage down a bit. Now notice that as the voltage gets lower, the light output reduces as well, and you can see there that dropping the voltage by a mere 2 volts down to 22 volts has resulted in a reduction to 695 lux, so that relatively small drop in voltage has more than halved the light output. It's important to say at this point that this is not a reflection of the quality of the strip, it's just a consequence of trying to make the strip do something it's not designed to. What about the other strip? This is the ROBUS Ultra, and this one has a maximum installed length of 30 meters, which is a really impressive number and definitely earns it the Ultra moniker there. Now let's perform the same test. You can see that the starting light level is 2.02 kilo lux, or 2020 lux. Then we dial the voltage down to 22 volts again and look at the light output. Now, we've actually gone just a hair under 22 volts, and it's barely changed at all with that change in voltage. It's down to just 2010 lux. So it's only varied by 10 lux, which is hardly anything at all. Effectively, it's not changing. Incredible. How does it do it? Well, it can't be just thicker conductors reducing volt drop because we've forced it to operate at a lower voltage. This section of copper is making a negligible difference. If you cast your mind back to the very first video in this series, you'll recall that the strip had these tiny resistors on that helped limit the flow of current into the LEDs. But looking at the Ultra, there's no such device visible on the surface of the strip. However, if we look really closely at the first LED on the individual sections of strip, you can see there's a tiny black dot in there. This dot isn't a simple resistor, but rather a tiny integrated circuit called a linear current regulator. The electronic principles as to how this works are pretty complex and beyond the scope of this video, but basically the chip adjusts the voltage automatically to keep the current through the LEDs stable, even if the power supply changes. In other words, the chip acts like a smart gatekeeper, ensuring your LEDs get the right amount of power to shine brightly and last longer. So what happens if you exceed these maximum lengths? Well, let's connect up this 30 meter length of normal Vegas strip to a power supply and find out. Before we turn it on, I'll just point out that the power supply is big enough to power the circuit and is the correct voltage. We covered selecting the correct driver in the previous video in this series. You can see that the strip is doing its best, but as you get to the end of the circuit, it just doesn't have sufficient voltage to power it up, and the individual LEDs get gradually dimmer. Can you get around this by applying a 24 volt power supply to a 12 volt strip and doubling the maximum recommended length? No. As we saw in the first video of this series, the individual sections of strip are made up of a number of LEDs connected in series with each other and protected from too much current flowing through them by a resistor. These components are selected and installed to work with a specified voltage, in this case 12 volts. If you apply 24 volts to them, you'll risk damaging the components and the strip might end up not working at all. But there's another problem rather than just dim lights that can come from using LED strip that's too long. You've probably searched online and found super cheap, colour changing, all singing, all dancing LED strip at incredible prices. This is one that I got from an online retailer that offers free next day delivery, and I installed it some time ago in my daughter's bedroom. And look at it now. This is what happens when I cycle through all the colours. So let's go for red to start with. You can see there, that's looking pretty good. Then let's go to green, and it's starting to look not so good. Blue is equally appalling, and my own personal favourite. If we go to white, look at what happens there. Absolutely beautiful, uniform, white-coloured effect. And even better, let's just put it on fade, so that it looks absolutely dreadful, no matter what mode it's in. Lesson learnt: buy cheap, have an unhappy daughter. But why has this happened? Well, it's because you get what you pay for. These LED strips are so cheap because the individual components they're using, the LEDs, the little resistors in there, and possibly even the copper strip connecting it all together, will be of correspondingly low quality as well. This can lead to the type of premature failure that we can see on this strip. Getting your LED strip from a reputable manufacturer like ROBUS means you can be confident that the components are good quality and much less likely to fail. So to make sure that your LED strip won't suffer from premature failure or uneven levels of brightness, the formula is simple. Buy quality product from a reputable manufacturer, use the correct voltage driver for the strip you're installing, and don't exceed the maximum lengths of strip recommended by the manufacturer. So why do brands like ROBUS sell reels of strip that are longer than the recommended maximum length? Well, it's pretty simple. It's so that professional installers who understand how to specify and design the correct lengths, power ratings, environments, and drivers of LED strip can create exactly what they need and use the strip across multiple areas of a project or even across multiple projects. It's the same reason you can buy 100 meters of cable on a drum, even though many circuits won't comply with a 100 meter length due to volt drop and ZS limitations. Now, I'm going to break all the rules that I just told you about and install double the maximum recommended length of LED strip and show you a hack to make it work just fine. If you're watching on our training platform, then answer the multiple choice questions that follow and move on to the next video to find out how. If you're watching on one of our social media channels, then click the link to move over to the free training package and get yourself a certificate. Or you can watch the same video in the series right here. All that remains is to say, thank you very much for watching.